Hi guys, in this video we're going to be taking a look at the Yola and Sailfish in amongst all this mess. And yes, another one of the clocks has turned up. This one has got a sort of a roundish face, so I'm looking forward to that one. yeah, this place is in a bit of a mess due to various reasons, but I'm using the microphone which is on the camera at the moment because yeah, mobile phones working, they happen to put out a lot of interference which caused some grief. So let's get some of this crap out of the way. yeah, at some point I've got to take this apart and see what's inside it. It's a memory card from an old 64 meg, not gig, meg, from an old camera that we've just ditched. And a few other bits and pieces. And right, now we've got a bit of free space, let's get the phone on here and try and get some focus on this. Let's try and zoom in a bit and let's see what's going on. Right, the long story short on all this malarkey is that phones are a bit of an odd subject at the moment. So we're just going to start this one up. Now, the Yola when it came out was quite inventive. It has what's called the other half, and you can change the other half to do various bits and pieces, and it carried chips or whatever you like. Sensors would actually tell, whoops, the baby. There goes that clock. I'm falling on the floor. I don't think that's going to work now. At least it fell on the floor before I assembled it. That's the only good thing I can say. Phones are a bit of an awkward thing. Wiley Fox and Cyanogen have basically hit the deck. Shuttleworth has also sounded the death knell for the Ubuntu phone for Unity, and we're left with the only real challenger at the moment, the only real challenger that I've got to show you at least, being the Yola running Sailfish. Now this was one of the first ones when they first came out. And I got a few different backs to it, but I was a bit disappointed in a number of things. At the moment, Android and iOS seem unstoppable and appear to be the only current mainstream, well-supported mobile phone operating systems on the market today. Microsoft's Windows phone is either dead or still very much alive and kicking, depending on who you listen to. But it didn't really, despite Microsoft's best efforts, or rather not best efforts really, didn't attract the developers that they wanted in order to make the application base. So, that leaves Sailfish. Yola and Sailfish have a reasonable pedigree. For those of you who don't know, Nokia was working on an operating system called Migo. When they were taken over by Microsoft, they let the team go and basically abandoned the project. The team started Yola, and Migo became Sailfish. They started working on their own hardware, some very innovative designs. It's a nice designed phone, to be perfectly honest. Physical. Sailfish 1 had a few problems. They didn't really solve them properly, I don't think, over the first couple of years. Things like one video recording was a sod. I mean, if I had it in the car and tried to do a selfie video while I was driving, the damn thing would either lock up or it just wouldn't store the video. But we are now on Sailfish 2.0. something or other, to be less accurate. Or at least slightly more accurate, and still being less accurate at the same time. So why will Sailfish potentially survive against Google and Apple? Pretty much the Russians and China. They don't like being beholden to Google and Apple, so it looks like Yola has got some funding, stroke involvement. What the deals are, I don't know, couldn't tell you, but things are going on. Now, the phone was again, the interface was designed around gesture control and is again another step up. Well, step up, step sideways, really. Whether it's up or not depends on your viewpoint, and I will not pull any punches. It will take some getting used to. Pretty much like we had to get used to Android in the first place, or when you pick up your first iPhone and get used to where everything is and how it works and what buttons go where, you've got the same sort of learning curve all over again. What I will say is, as I kept using it, it got better and it became more intuitive. Just tap twice. Did I turn it on? Yeah, and it should wake up. And yeah, let's just see if I can pull this back a little. The problem is the angle of my arm against the angle of the phone is not good. Tap it a couple of times, it wakes up. From the lock screen, you have a pull-down menu. I'm not sure how you're going to be able to see that. That says Gallery Settings and Phone. But you can. There used to be various pull menus, but now you've just got swipe. Swipe to the left or swipe to the right to unlock. And you can see instantly you've got four apps down the bottom, which are just there. So if you just tap the screen, up come the four apps that you that you most commonly use. At the top, I don't know if you can see it, you've got a clock, Wi-Fi and signal strength and battery percentage. And if you swipe from the left or the right, you now get location. There's any notifications. You don't have to edge swipe. In the old version 1, whether you edge swiped was one action, as opposed to just swiping, which is another action, interpreted different ways. Now it isn't. We've got an instant, just no notification, weather. So I'm going to go into the weather, and that's going to give me a bit more detail, and I can get more detail on any of that. If I just long hold, it should take me into the weather app, I hope. Or is it double tap? I'm at an odd angle now. And there goes the light. Bloody typical. Let's try this one. This one's on mains, so this one can't die on me. How do I get it? I did this earlier. Set alarm? No. I'm still getting used to the version 2 gestures, which are a complete pain in the neck, because they don't always do this. Powered by whatever. Ah, there we go. Hit the powered by and then I'm into the full weather app. No, I'm not. It's actually bringing up a browser. And it's taking me to slightly more detail on Hayward's Heath. How the hell do I get into that? Let's try that again, shall we? I did it at some point, I swear I did it, and it gave me different locations. connect to, search, make a note. You've got a lot of actions to learn, in other words. Let's try the apps. Weather. Where is the weather? There. So starting the weather app, I've got another location in here, London, which I'm asking for. Partly cloudy is giving me more details, and I can ask for, I can switch between the days. I don't know if I can change the settings, more information or update. Nothing much in the way of settings by the looks of it, so I'm just going to swipe that away. There's a tile. I'm going to start up another tile for settings. So as you can see, as you start gathering tiles, they go there. Let's take a quick trip to the store. Now, one of the big problems, which is also an opportunity, and depending on which way you look at it, you can see the store, relatively straightforward. New apps, you can see. You can go to that if you wish. The problem is, I've got real problems. Real problems trying to read that text. It's a nightmare. So I don't know who, but left and right swipe is where you go. You've got top apps, games, marketplace. So, damn, I actually meant to play apps. Apps latest, so you can see what's going on. Or you can actually do a search. You can just hit search on there, or go to my apps, or sort them if you wish. Let's try a sort. What options do we have? Latest, most liked, or most downloaded? Most liked. File browser, which happens to be installed. Funny that. yeah, I'll take you to... just swipe that minimum, and you can bring that up. Let's bring this up and ask for the gallery as well. There's not very much in here. In terms of gallery, because it was a factory reset. Now we've got four tiles open, you can see roughly what those occupy. I'm going to open another, which is, let's just say messages or phone. Phone, for example, what the hey. You can now see that no calls, pull down to call a friend, and you can call a contact or enter a phone number. And hey presto, it's gone in, so you can have like nine tiles of running processes. How's its performance? Quite reasonable. Photos. You can see photos, relatively straightforward. It tells you swipe here to go to previous view, so you can swipe there and you go back. Where you swipe and where you touch has an effect on what happens and how it behaves, and learning that is what the is part of the whole thing, really. These are the default images that pretty much come with the phone, or come with Sailfish, I should say, because they've stopped manufacturing the phone, and you can just swipe through them. Or if you use it sideswipe, yeah, sideswipe from the edge, and then it goes back. if you touch, you go into here, and from here, you can either swipe there to swipe the images, or swipe there to go back. Then you go back again, and you can go into videos, and you have the videos that are on board, and you can Bluetooth them, or add an account, or do other options, show details. You know, you've got various options that are in different places. Tap anywhere, that pretty much stops it, pauses it, and you can use that to jump to various places and start playing it again. So you can do that sort of thing, bounce back again, we're just going to go to there. Now, this is supposed to be able to run run Android apps as well, but I have had real problems, especially with version 2. I've got phone, messages, browser and camera, settings, gallery, store, whoops, there it goes, people. I've also got notes here, tutorial, which you can go through, file browser, terminal, tiny edit, clock and weather. Some of these come as default, some of them I'd recommend you get hold of. So, is this going to focus, is the question? I don't know. I strongly I've got secure Wi-Fi at home, which necessitated actually putting a file on here with a Wi-Fi password and opening it up, and cutting and pasting before I did various things. Tiny Edit is pretty good. That's a nice little running around in... NU. Does it have nude? No, it doesn't. Nude. Yeah, it's got nude. Running around in the nude, and you can do various things. Save, open, save as, new, the usual stuff. And you've also got the box standard selection that you can use to change. And if you hold down, it actually zooms in as per usual, as you'd expect with many bits and pieces. And then you've got the cut, paste, whatever you want to do with it. so, now we've got 7 open. As well as that, you have themes. Where the heck are the themes? If you hold down the power button... hold down the power button. and it should bring the themes up. And you've got theme options, silent work party, salamander. You can program these yourself. Oh, come on. So you can go to silent if you wish, and that will do things. I've just gone into work. These are the predefined themes that come with it. And the ambience changes, it changes the colours dynamically. Whoops, that's the ringer volume. And, okay, let's try this again. Shall we? Let's just unlock, go down. Where the heck are the themes? Because they're not called themes, are they? How the hell do I get into that? No, I don't want to lock. I actually want to get back into the themes. Oh, that's favourites. God damn it. It's finding out where the hell the options are, and it's a bit of an arse. Is it under settings? Ambiances. Oh, there you go. Under settings, ambiances. Then you have the ambiances that are available, and you can add them to favourites, etc. Intense, for example. You can edit that. There's the picture. You can change the picture, and it will pick up the colours. And you have the ambience colour that it tries to work out from. And it will change, tap to reset, and it'll actually analyse the picture for the colour that's going to throw the next. You can have it showing the top menu, which is the favourites, basically. You've got all the various ring effects, ringtone volume, etc. So you can change all these, and they become part of the ambience. Say ringtone Yola, you can just listen to it if you want. Or you can select it from the music files, no file. There's all sorts. The first one. Now the first one is one of the themes. The first one is you know, it does come down as a theme if you had the first one and you had the what was it? I've forgotten the back, but it was it came down. Right. So basically, that's that one. So we're going to say set the ambience, and that's going to be set, and that's done. The ambience is now set again. So you can switch between them relatively easily, and to just hold down, yada yada, and just switch between what you want. Okay. Settings. You have all sorts. Let's just unlock this. As you can probably work out, I don't have any lock code on this at the moment. Of course, I'm in there because I'm part of settings. Display. Adjust sleep after 70 seconds. Keep display on while charging. You can have that. So effectively, if you're at home, you can use it as a clock. Just look at it. Orientation, dynamic, text size. Ooh, text size, enlarge. We'll have that, thank you very much. sounds and feedback. You can control various bits and pieces for your theme in here. System sounds, touchscreen tones and vibration. Gestures. You have some control over gestures. Edge swipes. Quick app closing. And top edge swipe will close the app. Ah, good. Events view, you've got various shortcuts, actions, instant install calendar from store. Ooh, there's a calendar, is there? Where am I? Events view. Install calendar from store, I'm going to have to look at that to see if I can hook it up with work. Lock screen, you have your lock screen options in here. what is going on with the focus on this? I don't know what the heck's going on here. I don't know if it's in focus, out of focus, or what. I'm just going to have to leave it on there. But you have the shortcuts that you want to put in the top pull-down. And other options. Wireless LAN, mobile network, VPN, flight mode, location, USB, USB. Default mode, always ask. Media transfer, I think, for me. So I can actually... That's one thing that I've really wanted. But it got removed from Android, is the default USB mode. Bluetooth sync presence is unavailable on here. Sailfish operating system updates. This will tell us what OS this is. It was updated last night to 2.1.0.11. And you can check, as you expect, check on updates for wireless LAN only, manual always, so you can avoid ramping up your data charge on your network. Language, text input, device lock, certificates, developer tools that you've got, transfers, data counters, home network, roaming, yada yada. Is this a two SIM device? I'm not sure. No, it isn't. Or is it? I think it's either a two SIM device or two SIM and memory card in the back. I do think it's reasonably flexible-ish, I think. And yeah, so you've got a reasonable amount of settings. Now, one of the things about the store is that, which is both a good thing and a bad thing, it depends on where you are and where you are in the debate, is that it's got like Russian apps, Chinese apps, all sorts of other apps in there, different languages. It's as far as the trust goes. Oh, untrusted software. Oh, allow untrusted software. Accept. I wonder if that was causing a problem. Because what I was doing is untrusted software. Let's go back to File Manager, wherever the hell that is. There. Let's go to Downloads. Let's try and install Sol Calendar. So let's just try and install that. Will it work? Will it not? I don't think this is going to work. Nope, didn't work. How about Wi-Fi Analyzer? Is that going to work? I don't think so. But yeah, you do have a trust software in there somewhere. I'm not 100% sure how it works, but it's supposed to be able to load Android Android applications. Personally, I'm having problems with it, but there you go. I'll hopefully bring you up to the... I hope you can see that. I can't see if you're seeing it. Those are my default apps that are either installed on the phone as they come, or I've installed them, I've got them on low security Wi-Fi, in other words Wi-Fi with a small short password that I could easily type in. Then when I had a Tiny Edit and File Manager, I was able to cut and paste the longer Wi-Fi password into the phone for the Wi-Fi. So you have all the usual stuff. Let's just run the tutorial. Learn the basics of OS Sailfish and it'll take you through it. Start. Here's the lock screen. Here is lock screen. Swipe from the left or right edge to unlock. This is home, showing your minimized apps. And then we go on swipe right to access events, or left to access events, indeed. Here are your notifications and social feeds. It's got a link to Microsoft Exchange by the looks of this, so it's going to be interesting to see whether or not, well done, continue. So you can go through all this, and in theory we can just swipe down from the top in order to close this. I bloody hope so. Oh, damn it. What have I done? These are your installed apps. Yes, I know. Now bugger off and go and play somewhere else. Oh, damn it. Swipe from top to close it. Yeah. Don't start this unless you mean to go through it. Yeah, tap to open. So there you are, search from people. Swipe from the left or right to go home. And well done. Close. Yeah, there it is, that's gone. So yeah, the store contains apps from a number of different countries in a number of different languages. And the text sometimes is so small that I would really suggest... looking up applications from other places on the web to see what other people are using, and then doing a search within the App Store to try and find them. I say try, you don't have to try and find them, the search is actually pretty good. Pardon me. The one issue that I had in this, well, it's been a number of issues really. Yola themselves stopped on the hardware side. They started off with a tablet, and I think the tablet is still available. There's also a Yola watch which will connect to the phone. And from what I've seen, based on the gesture side of things, if you get on with the gestures, then the watch looks like it might actually be worthwhile. Depending, in other words, I'd be interested in getting my hands on it. Hands on it, watch, get it. Yeah. I think they started with the phone some years ago, stopped with the phone, and decided that they were just going to... I think the tablet was announced at that point, Then shortly after, they backed out of the hardware side and said they were just going to concentrate on the operating system itself. Next thing I know, there's a Yola smartwatch. So exactly what the heck's going on here, I don't know. But it's got it's going to have a wider than a very wide basis of applications, which are going to be in a wide range of languages, and it's purely developer driven. I mean, the one thing that I really hated from a part of this was the community-driven aspect of this, because most of the community at the time were developers, and not very much in terms of input from actual users. So any suggestions that users put forward seemed to play second fiddle to the developers. I put forward a few ideas, which some, you know, it's crazy. I mean, I put forward ideas. They were then voted down. Somebody else put them forward. Then they were voted up and accepted. Other stuff, despite having reservations and explaining a few bits and pieces, weren't solved. So there's quite a bit of history there for me. I just did not get on with it. And it's not a case of not getting on with to Sailfish so much, because they did do a number of things, including putting the date and time on the lock screen. The date was important to me because when I was like rocking up in a car park in winter with gloves on, you know, in the early morning, I just needed to be able to tap that with a gloved hand and see what the time and date was. And so they did make some changes like that. I really do think that they could have done with more input from the user base rather than the dev base. Whether you regard that as a good thing or a bad thing is neither here nor there, really. That's just how it happened. And when you're looking at a new device, typically it's the developers who take it forward in the first place. So I think that it's... If the community has actually grown, I don't know. And some feedback from users has risen. I haven't got a clue. I hadn't really played a part in the community there for quite some time. So the long story short is the only one that looks as if it's going to have any reasonable legs to take on Google and iOS is going to be Sailfish. I would expect it to, with the backing of the Russians and the Chinese. I would expect it to really take off in Asia and Russia and other places rather than Europe and the Americas. And it's going to gain legs over there, where Android and iOS will probably wind up falling out of favour. Even though there's Russian and China involvement, I've got faith in this because it is open source. So if anything untoward is going on, it should be spotted and called out. So... the store, you know, a lot of apps in different languages. You're just going to have to work your way through. If you happen to be a multilingual person, then you'll probably love this, because you'll have a much wider range of things. What exactly are the requirements to actually get your app in the store? I don't know. I think for me the most important is calendar, and being able to hook the calendar up to work. That's one of the major things for me. And two email accounts, both work and private. If I can get that running, then I'll be happy. I'll be happy to use this as a daily driver. If I can't, then I've got a problem. What I may wind up doing is using two email accounts, two email apps, the onboard email for the personal, and an exchange. I think there's a separate app on there for exchange, to use for exchange. Unfortunately, Sol Calendar that I use on Android to access the works calendar is not installing on here. So that's a bit of a ball ache, but that's how it rocks. So long story short is you've got to give it time. You've got to work with it, and you've got to stick with it. It's like any other operating system. It is so vastly different to iOS and Android in the gesture base that you can't expect to run with this within a few hours. You've just got to persevere because it is a different way of working. I do like the swipe and gesture base aspects of it. I prefer it to some of the touch stuff. But now that we're up to version 2, I was only using it as a daily driver when it was on version 1, and now Sailfish is on version 2. I'm ready to give it another try, depending on actually getting the applications on there in the first place. I used to use Firefox on it under revision 1, and with the APK for Wi-Fi, Analyzer and Sol Calendar failing to install, you know, my faith in this is sort of shaken a bit. But we will see what happens and see where it goes. Exactly where you would buy a phone with Sailfish on, I don't know. I think it's probably... I think it's still in the development phases. In other words, developers are getting other phones and porting Sailfish to them. That's where I think it is right now. The tablet, I don't know. I think you can buy it. As for the Yola watch, I don't know. But I'm certainly not jumping before I can walk, even. This phone has got to earn its place as a daily driver before I start investing any more. I had great hopes. Came across problems which are expected, and that's about it. But if you really hate iOS and Android, then have hope. There is stuff out there which has legs and it has reasonable backing. So that's a look at this. Hope you've enjoyed it. I'm not immediately jumping from the Wily Fox to this yet. Got to do a few more tests and try things out to make sure I can do what I want to before I actually switch things out. The other concern that I've got, obviously, is for the batteries. The battery is replaceable, but the question is, as they stop manufacturing the phones, where would I get one? That's a big question. And we'll see what happens. It may actually be a standard battery, I don't know. So, there's a long way to go yet. An awful long way to go. And I'll see you in the next video. Bye for now.